I will read his presentation, and hopefully maybe he'll be on for the question and answer period. Dr. Javier Pérez Royo is professor of constitutional law at the University of Seville. He cites numerous contributions to collected volumes and professional journals. He's the author of La Reforma Constitucional Inviable, The Infeasible Constitutional Reform, and Curso de Derecho Constitucional, Course on Constitutional Law, which is now running its 15th edition. So it's a book that is obviously a textbook for the university students and is highly successful. He is a regular contributor to newspapers like El País, ARA, and the online journal eldiario.es. He's given a title for his presentation. He calls it Centralization as the Norm, Autonomy as the Exception. It was with the Constitution of 1978 that for the first time a process of political decentralization of the state was produced. This process has operated with stability over an extended period of time. When it comes to the integration formula of Catalonia into the state, the Constitution of 1978 is quite precise. There is a territorial constitution for Catalonia, the Basque Country, and Galicia in the Constitution of 1978, not for the other territories. The Constitution is basically thought of for Catalonia. Said territorial constitution is a compromise between the principle of political unity of the state and the exercise of the right to autonomy of Catalonia. This compromise is expressed through a pact between the Parliament of Catalonia and the Congress of Deputies, and thereafter subject to referendum by the Catalan population. The Catalan nationality cannot impose on the state the statute of autonomy with which the state does not agree. The Congress of Deputies has to accept the project of statute sent by the Parliament of Catalonia. This is the guarantee that works to the advantage of the principle of political unity of the state. But the state also can't impose onto the nationality a statute that hasn't been specifically approved by a referendum of the Catalan citizens. This is the guarantee that works to the advantage of the right to autonomy. It is a double guarantee. It's a double guarantee system. On one hand, we have the principle of political unity. It works in favor of the state. On the other hand, we have the right to autonomy, which works in favor of the nationality. The Congress of Deputies is the bearer of the first. The Catalan electoral body is the bearer of the second. This territorial constitution was put into practice in 1979-1980 with the approval of the statute of autonomy that was in effect until 2006. This was the best period Catalonia's integration into the state. Said integration is in large part due to the success of the Constitution of 1978. In 2006, the reform of the Statute of Autonomy was approved, respecting the territorial constitution. The Catalan Parliament approved the project of the reform law. The Congress of Deputies revised it and reached a pact with the Catalan Parliament. Then it was subjected to a referendum. It took effect in July of 2006, and the integration of Catalonia into the state didn't pose any type of problem. In 2010, the Constitutional Court, in the ruling 31-2010, practically canceled the relevant content of the statutory reform, in this manner discrediting the pact between the two parliaments and not recognizing the result of the referendum. Materially, the Constitutional Court destroyed the territorial constitution. From this moment, Catalan nationalism, accompanied by a percentage of the non-nationalist population, or in any case, not pro-independence, begins requesting a call for a referendum, so the citizens of Catalonia can be the ones to decide the formula of their integration into the state, the so-called right to decide. The referendum that was at the point of arrival in the Constitution of 1978, first the pact between the two parliaments and afterwards the referendum, was transferred to the starting point. Given that one cannot trust that the state, that is to say, the Constitutional Court, would recognize the result of the referendum at the point of arrival, we want a referendum that cannot be subject to control by the Constitutional Court. The relations between Catalonia and the state over the last 7 years have centered around the call to referendum. This has been a constant tension between the Catalan Parliament and the Catalan autonomous government on one side, and the General Courts and the Spanish government on the other. The Catalan Parliament and the autonomous government were able to organize two consultations, one on the 9th of November of 2014, and the other on the 1st of October of 2017. They were very important politically. Legally, they have no value whatsoever. They have been a challenge to the state, one that has had repercussions beyond the Spanish borders. The reaction of the state to each of these two consultations has been similar, although of a very different intensity in each case. The reaction to the 9 November consultation in 2014 was of a limited intensity. The office of the Spanish Attorney General filed charges against Catalan President Artur Mas and two ministers of the High Court of Justice of Catalonia for the crimes of disobedience and perversion of justice, whose sentences don't involve terms of imprisonment, only of disqualification from office. The sentence was a one-year disqualification. The reaction to the October 1st in 2017 was similar in that the Spanish government turned to the penal courts, but different in that the intensity of the penal reaction was much higher. Also, in addition to the penal reaction, a political constitutional reaction also occurred with the activation of the so-called federal coercion foreseen in Article 155 of the Spanish Constitution. The activation of the federal coercion has translated into the suspension of Catalonia's autonomy. The Catalan government has been dismissed, the Catalan parliament has been dissolved, the national government calling for Catalan elections to be held on December 21st. The temporal scope of the suspension is limited to 54 days from the decree that dissolved the Catalan parliament to the date when the citizens will head to the polls. Politically, this is a low-intensity suspension of autonomy, since as the Catalan parliament is dissolved, the Catalan government is replaced by an acting government. The substitution of the Catalan government by the Spanish government is almost insignificant in practice. But in terms of the action in the courts of justice, the activation of the federal coercion has had an extraordinary transcendence. The dismissal of the Catalan government and the dissolving of the Catalan parliament has led to the members of the Catalan government and the General Committee of the Parliament of Catalonia losing their jurisdictional immunity. Spain's Attorney General has taken advantage of this circumstance to put in place processes against all of them at breakneck speed. The irregularity in this way of proceeding is nothing short of extraordinary. The chief public prosecutor has sued all of them for the crime of rebellion, which is a type of crime that, in almost unanimous agreement with legal doctrine, does not fit any of their actions. He has registered the charges against the members of the Catalan government before the National High Court, which is a body that does not have the jurisdiction for the crime, in agreement not only with legal doctrine, but also with the opinion of all of the judges of the very National High Court gathered in official assembly, December 2nd, 2003. The judge of Court of Investigation number 3 of the National High Court has assumed jurisdiction without respecting the rules of distribution among the different courts. The judge has dictated the most extreme precautionary measures, imprisonment without bail, in the absence of what the overwhelming majority of doctrine considers the necessary motivation to adopt said measure. Neither crime of rebellion, nor a competent judicial body, nor a competent investigative judge. Everything is of an exceeding irregularity. Catalan President Puigdemont and four ministers are in Belgium. They are challenging before the Belgian justice system the European arrest warrant issued by the judge of the National High Court that asks that they be handed over to the Spanish justice system. The charge against the members of the General Committee of the Catalan Parliament was registered before the Supreme Court, since the Parliament's President, Carme Forcadell, thus retained jurisdictional immunity. Actually, the charge should have been registered before the High Court of Justice of Catalonia, the jurisdictional body to which the President of the Catalan Parliament answers to. The interpretation on which Spain's Attorney General has justified the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is devoid of any basis. The President's action took place in Barcelona, but its effects could extend beyond the territory of Catalonia, and therefore must fall under the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court.
This is an attempt to marginalize Catalonia's bodies of justice administration. The charges for the crimes of rebellion against the members of the Catalan government should have been brought to the Provincial Court of Barcelona, and the charges against the members of the General Committee of the Catalan Parliament should have been brought before the High Court of Justice of Catalonia. It seems that the assumption by Spain's Supreme Court of the jurisdiction over the actions of the members of the General Committee of the Catalan Parliament will lead to all of the charges being concentrated in the Supreme Court, and that this will be the body that will end up deciding the verdicts on all the charges. We will see how all of these issues will end. Obviously, the political and constitutional problem of the integration of Catalonia into the state continues without any credible expectation that it will be resolved through the sentences the Supreme Court will hand out. After the 21st of December, Catalonia will continue to be the biggest political and constitutional problem that Spanish society will have to face. So next will be Professor Pamela Radcliffe. She's the chair of the History Department of the University of California at San Diego. She's an expert on mass politics in Spain at the end of the Franco era and during the transition to democracy. She's the author, among other books, of From Mobilization to Civil War, The Politics of Polarization in the Spanish City of Gijón, 1900 to 1937, and more recently, Making Democratic Citizens in Spain, Civil Society, and the Popular Origins of the Transition.
Thank you, and thank you for organizing this panel and for including me along with all of these other great experts and scholars. Okay, so, so my goal as a historian of popular movements, of social movements, is to give you some historical context and framework to understand these kinds of images. That is the massive demonstrations that we've seen in the streets in Catalonia for anyone who's following the story. And most of the media coverage has focused on the decisions of the government, of the elites. But on the other hand, we've also seen these images, right, of hundreds of thousands of people in the street. So what I really want to talk about is the role of this popular mobilization in the independence movement. So I have two major points to make. The first one is that is an argument about continuity. That is, on one level, there's nothing surprising about this mobilization because it's part of a long tradition of a robust civil society in Catalonia. Of all of the regions of Spain, Catalonia has one of the sort of deepest traditions of popular mobilization in civil society going back to the 19th century. And what I want to argue is that that tradition of popular mobilization, it's not exclusive to Catalonia, but what that tradition really has done is it sets forth an alternative set of claims about governance and legitimacy that are based on popular participation, direct democracy, assemblyism, and that's a tradition, again, that goes back to the 19th century. And that that set of claims, of course, is in contrast to what we might call procedural liberal democracy, right, where the legitimacy lies in the institutions and the procedures, the legal procedures. So what I want to sort of get to at the end is that you have these competing frameworks of the legitimacy of democracy and how you actually define what that is that are competing and contrasting with each other, and you can see that in the crisis today. So as a historian, what I want to do is kind of take you back to the origins of this tradition of mass mobilization. But before that, I want to make just, I've got some images and I just put the next slide up so you can kind of take a look at them. The second major point I want to make, so the first major point is about the continuity, right, with a long tradition of mass mobilization. The second point I want to make is one of discontinuity. That is, most of that tradition of mobilization has not been focused on Catalanism or certainly on Catalan independence, but has been largely focused on labor movement, class struggle, the kind of popular democracy or revolutionary movements of socialism and anarchism, which had an important role in Catalonia. So at this time, right, when the tradition of popular mobilization is largely rooted in this kind of class conflict, if we look at what Catalanism looks like in this period, it's largely an elite movement, right? On the left, the photo is of the cultural movement of the Renascença, which is a literary movement that is searching for a Catalan identity that's rooted in culture and language and customs. On the right, you have the first Catalanist political party, which is not advocating for independence, but for autonomy. And you can tell by the photo up there that this is not a popular movement, right? These are largely businessmen. And it's really a political party that wants to lead Spain to economic success through Catalan's industrial power. Okay, so I think one of the important turning points, and I'm skipping through all sorts of things, but one of the important turning points that really begins to bring these two trends together, that is, on the one hand, Catalanism, which is largely a sort of elite, top-down movement, and the kind of popular mobilization tradition, one of the turning points is the Franco dictatorship. And the reason for that is because that dictatorship, of course, is, broadly repressive. As you can imagine, it would be repressive of labor movements and socialist and anarchist mobilizing, but it's also specifically repressive, right, against Catalan culture and language. So that sort of umbrella of anti-Francoism begins to bring those two threads together. And what I have up here is the beginning of anti-Francoist mobilization on the part of the labor movement, which most social movement theorists would see as the word I have up there in social movement theory is the early risers. The labor movement is one of the earliest and strongest opponents of the regime. But you can also see that in Catalanist civil society, you have opposition to the Franco regime. One of the earliest and most important cultural organizations, Òmnium Cultural, which if you're following the news today, remains one of the important organizations. And they're largely, in this period, of course, they're largely dedicated to defending Catalan language and culture at a time when the state is trying to prevent people from even speaking Catalan, right, and reading Catalan. And so you can see the statistics I have up there about the language schools. So the other important anti-Francoist organization in Catalonia towards the end of the regime in particular is the Assemblea de Catalunya. You can see the dates up there. That is a platform that brings together all of the anti-Francoist parties from Christian Democrats to the communists, and it brings them together, as you can see up there, under, for the first time, a platform that begins to bring together Catalanism and sort of popular democratic goals. So you can see the sort of bringing together of those two threads, again, through this anti-Francoist umbrella. And all of these popular movements, whether they're labor movements or popular democracy or Catalanism, culminate during the period of the transition, that's after the end of the dictatorship, and that several-year period between the dictatorship and the establishment of the current liberal democracy. And you can see there's all sorts of different kinds of movements. The labor movement is the one I've been talking about. Over here you have an image of neighborhood movements, and just to plug my book, I wrote a book about the neighborhood movements in Madrid, right? So that's how I know about them, as one of these emergent popular democratic movements. And most of these movements defended what I started out with, that defended a notion of democracy as rooted in popular participation, grassroots, direct democracy, assemblyism. So again, this is the continuation, right, of that long tradition. So what happens when the transition ends, when all of the new institutions are established, including the autonomous government institution in Catalonia, the Generalitat? Catalanism then really becomes, once again, a kind of top-down governmental project, right? Most of the initiative to establishing the boundaries of Catalan autonomy are essentially taken over by a center-right Catalanist party that rules for the next 25 years or so. So what happens to change this situation where all of these movements more or less disappear for a couple of decades, and most of the energy tour of Catalanism is top-down? What happens, of course, is what everyone has been talking about, which is the onset of both political and economic crisis, right? From 2000 and the economic part of the crisis around 2008-09. And two things happen, I think, in this period of crisis. One is a general resurgence of that popular mobilization that I was talking about. That tradition is coming back, and you can see these photos up here. Don't have to do with Catalanism specifically. There's just a revival of this sort of popular democracy. The Indignados movement, of course, was the famous popular democracy movement against the austerity. And these are images from Barcelona, but of course there are similar movements in the rest of the Spanish state. But of course there is also a specifically Catalan version or Catalanist version of that revival of popular mobilization. So at the same time that you have an economic crisis, you have a political crisis in Catalonia that coincides, and it's partly coincidental, that is, that the Supreme Court ruling, right, in 2010 is right at the moment when we have this economic crisis, right? Those two things come together to produce two things. First is the Supreme Court ruling is, I guess I would argue, it's kind of the failure of the top-down Catalanist project, right? Because they pursued that through legal procedural channels, and it has now failed with the Supreme Court turning it down. And so you get a revival of a kind of popular Catalanist movement that really takes the initiative at this point. So the two major popular civil society organizations that really step into the breach at this point is Òmnium Cultural, who I mentioned before, and one of my colleagues who's a Catalan linguist said there's an ethnographic story to be told about the transition of this association from basically a cultural, an association defending culture to an independence organization. And then the second organization is the Asamblea Nacional de Catalunya, and you can see that the name is taken specifically right from that organization from the 1970s, that umbrella organization I mentioned before. That is formed in 2012, and the Asamblea Nacional de Catalunya has been responsible for most of those major independence demonstrations. The first specifically independence demonstration in Catalonia was September 11th of 2012. For those of us in America, September 11th has a different valence, but that's of course Catalan National Day, and you can see the those events in 2012, 13, and 14. Okay, so one other part, one other kind of piece, and I don't have time to go into this in great detail, but one other piece of this kind of grassroots initiative in terms of Catalan independence is what I would call municipal Catalanism. And the best expression of that is the fact that you know, where you could not have a referendum legally at the level of Catalonia, the autonomous region, 552 municipalities in Catalonia organized their own local referenda for independence, partly encouraged by this left-wing party, the CUP, which is both independentist and municipalist. So that's another aspect of kind of the bottom-up sort of initiative, right, of this movement in the last few years. So just to conclude, this last photo up here, this last slide is something that I can't really talk about, but you have this interesting phenomenon of the civil society leaders now going into government. So the people who have become famous, some of them, unfortunately, Moria Casals died, but she, before that, she started as an Unión Cultural leader and then became a deputy. The same thing happened with, you know, with Carmen Forfidel. Okay, so what does this add to our understanding of the Catalan independence movement, looking at this kind of bottom-up grassroots movement? So what I see is this coming together, right, of these two traditions. On the one hand, Catalanism and Catalan independence, and on the other hand, this tradition of mass mobilization, and particularly the mass mobilization that is rooted, again, in this kind of participatory notion, right, of democratic legitimacy. So what I see then happening is the upshot that the Spanish government and the Catalan independence movement are speaking these completely distinct languages of democratic legitimacy that are talking past each other, right? The Spanish government is talking about the Constitution and the institutions, and the Catalanist movement is talking about the popular will and popular democracy and participation. And the, you know, without arguing, I mean, I think that there is some legitimacy to both of those kinds of democratic claims, but what we have is a situation where neither acknowledges the legitimacy of the other, and it's, instead of dialoguing, it's partly contributed to the impasse where we are today.